great smile, some pretty big ideas about baptism, and a great sense of humor. The second verse of that song would be about ministry shared together. Over those years, we spent time, a lot of time with weddings and marriages. We spent time with funerals as we buried many faithful saints and dear friends. And Pastor was always known to make a big splash at a lot of baptisms. The second, third verse, rather, of that song would be also about a wedding. And that wedding would be about 27 years ago when Sharon and I were married. And the first thing that we did was to receive communion after we had been married. And it was Pastor Julie who offered communion. She was the celebrant at our wedding. The fourth verse of that song saw the Holy Spirit leading Pastor through a variety of calls and interesting places to be in different ways in which to serve the church. And today, Pastor Julie, you are here at Trinity. And Pastor Julie, Sharon, and I are deeply regretful that we cannot be here on this Sunday to welcome you, to hear your message, and to receive communion again from your hand. But I know the people of Trinity will welcome you warmly. And with that, I want to ask you, people of Trinity, to welcome her not as a stranger, but as one who has been in your midst gently for a number of years. For what you may not realize is that seeds that were sown many years ago have grown up to shape the way we worship at Trinity, and they have also influenced the way that your children and grandchildren have learned in the years of confirmation as they walk together with the guy wearing the robe. And so here on this third Sunday of Epiphany, I hope that we will hear closely the words of Scripture about discipleship and calling, and now it's time to rejoice, give thanks, and sing. So do you think David, her sermon's going to say anything about ostriches today?
So here's Pastor Julie in the flesh. We welcome her this morning. We're so happy. She drove in from Dubuque this morning, and when it was 8 below 0 or whatever it was. So we're very thankful that you're here.
Thank you.
Welcome. I'm Julie Blue. I'll be assisting minister this morning. And just a few announcements. The annual meeting is Sunday, February 18th. There will be one worship service at 9, and the meeting will follow immediately after at 10. The Sunday Supper Series today, Dr. Kathy Webb, the professor at Augustana College, will speak about the inequities faced by our sisters and brothers living with disabilities. That's this afternoon in Founders Hall from 4 to 6. A light meal follows the presentation, and the event is free. This Friday is the fourth Friday luncheon for the women. They'll be gathering at Miss Mamie's at 11 o'clock on Friday the 26th. Otherwise, most important, the survey. If you haven't received it online, it's here. Pick one up if you haven't had it already. The part of the call committee will be in the narthex at a table to answer any of your questions and help you get started with that. So stop by and say hi, and be sure to fill it out. We'd like everybody to fill that out. And this is for our congregational profile as we look to call a pastor for our church. Otherwise, I just would remind you to take your bulletin home with you. All the announcements and events and times are in the back of that, and so I would refer to that if you're looking for something. Okay.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light, and our salvation. Amen. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O Lord, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river your Son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word, you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life, and above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit and renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, by grace alone you call us and accept us in your service. Strengthen us by your Spirit and make us worthy of your call. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
The first reading is from Jonah, the third chapter. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk. And he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he would send to bring upon them, and he did not do it. What the Spirit is saying to the church. This reading is from 1 Corinthians, the 7th chapter. Brothers and sisters, the appointed time has grown short. For now on, let even those who have wives be as though they had none, and those who mourn as though they were not mourning, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing, and those who buy as though they had no possessions, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealing with it. For the present form of this world is passing away. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, Lord and Savior.
Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending their nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I wasn't nervous until I heard that John had recorded an introduction. And you never know where John's going to go. But I also wanted to say to you that John anonymously at the time gave me this chasuble, which I have been wearing for the last 25 years of ministry. And isn't it gorgeous? I mean, the guy really knew how to pick a beautiful chasuble, didn't he? The thing about being introduced by someone who knew you a long time ago is you don't know what they're going to say, what they're going to pick and choose from the story of your life. And that's exactly what we have happening in our text from Jonah today. If all you knew about the text, about Jonah's life and his experiences were from what we read today, you would think Jonah was the greatest guy ever. Yeah, not so much. How many of you have thought about the whole story of Jonah in the last 5 or 10 years? Okay, 3 or 4 of you. I'd be willing to bet that a lot of us don't remember much of anything about the story of Jonah except that he got swallowed by a fish, and then the fish actually vomited him onto the shore. And maybe you remember that he was running a little bit, but let's just kind of go over the story again. And as I go through this, I want you to imagine the various scenes as they unfold. And I want you to be ready to laugh, because this story is just crazy. It's ridiculous. The story begins with God saying to Jonah, "Go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come before me." Now, you probably all knew that Nineveh was wicked, because when you have studied Zephaniah and Nahum, you have read about the wickedness. Maybe you haven't studied I haven't studied Zephaniah and Nahum in I don't even know how long. But it was known in Jonah's time that Nineveh was a bad place. It wouldn't have surprised anybody hearing this story that when God said, "Go to Nineveh," Jonah didn't immediately jump up and eagerly make his way there. In fact, what he did was he went the other direction. Part of what makes this story funny is stuff in Hebrew, and I'm not going to bore you with very much, but just a little bit, that Jonah, son of Amittai, means dove, son of faithfulness. And so as the people who knew that, because they knew Hebrew, because that was their language, would have heard this story, they would have heard that Jonah, a dove, a son of faithfulness, turns and goes the wrong way, off looking for a ride to Tarshish. Tarshish is east, Nineveh's west, or the other way around, one of those two. Tarshish is west, and I don't even know what direction this is in here. Nineveh is east. And so imagine, if you can, Jonah kind of looking over his shoulder, at least metaphorically, if not physically, to see if God notices that he's going the wrong way. So the Lord, he gets on a boat, he finds a boat that's going to Tarshish, he buys a ticket, he gets on the boat, and God hurled a great wind upon the sea, such a mighty storm that the mariners were afraid and each cried out to his God. So this is a bunch of sailors who don't know God with the capital G, but they think that some sort of idol or some sort of spirit that they've heard of is going to save them. And of course those spirits or idols don't save them, but they're each praying and praying, and they're throwing stuff off the boat to lighten the load, and they are terrified. Now, sailors aren't supposed to be terrified in storms. I mean, this is their bread and butter, this is their business, but this one is so bad that they're terrified. What's Jonah doing? He's sleeping. Imagine him just snoring away, you know, sawing logs so loud that perhaps they can even hear it amidst the storm and all of its noise. And so the captain comes and says, "What are you doing asleep? Get up, call on your God. Maybe your God will spare us a thought so that we do not perish." And Jonah, that son of faithfulness, after all, Jonah knows that this is all on him. And so the sailors say, "Let's cast lots so we can find out on whose account this calamity has come upon us." And they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. And Jonah says, "Yeah." I know it doesn't say that in the Bible, but I think they just edited it out. Jonah says, "Yeah, I'm a Hebrew, and I'm probably the one who's responsible for this. I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." And so the sailors say, "Well, what have you done?" And they knew he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord because Jonah, son of faithfulness, had told them, "Well, I believe in this God and I'm running away from this God." Nevertheless, Nevertheless, the men rowed, R-O-W-E-D, hard to bring the ship back to land, but they couldn't. The sea grew more and more stormy against them. And then they cried out to the Lord, capital L, capital G, God, "Please, O Lord, we pray, don't let us perish on account of this man's, this dove of faithfulness's life. Don't make us guilty of innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you." Jonah must be a really good prophet. 20 minutes ago, all these guys were praying to gods that aren't real or idols or whatever, and he's got them praying to the real God just like that. So they picked Jonah up and they threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. And then the men feared the Lord, capital L, feared as in had a sense of awe, even more, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. They made promises to God, the God of Jacob, the God of Abraham. And the Lord provided a big fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of that fish 3 days and three nights. And what did Jonah do? What every one of us would have done. Started praying, and praying hard, for 3 days straight. He managed to make it very poetic. I'm not sure I would have been able to do that, but he has a beautiful poetic prayer in that's in the book of Jonah. And God listens to Jonah, speaks to the fish, and the fish spewed Jonah out upon the dry land. The actual Hebrew word means vomited him on the dry land. It seems to me if you've run from God and been swallowed by a fish, it's probably fitting that that fish vomits you up on the land. And then we get our text for today, where Jonah seems like, well, like a son of faithfulness, actually, because the word of the Lord comes to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up and go to Nineveh and proclaim to them the message that I tell you." And he goes and he starts walking across this three-day walk across Jonah. And he cried out, 40 days more and Nineveh shall be overthrown. Jonah apparently has not read his scriptures. If he had, he would know that prophets say, "The Lord told me to tell you," but he skips that part, perhaps because he really doesn't want anything good to happen in Nineveh. He says, "Yep, 40 days more and you are all all in trouble." Excuse me. Julie, would you get me a glass of water or get my Diet Pepsi? That would probably be better. I'm sorry? Yeah, please. And so Jonah goes to Nineveh. It's quite possible that while he's doing what God asked, that he's not trying very hard to make this a message of hope. Now, once again, we our reading for today skips some stuff that's really pretty interesting and also kind of funny. So the news reaches the people of Nineveh, and the king heard about what happened, or what Jonah's been saying, and he removed his robe and covered himself with sackcloth and sat in ashes, and then he made a proclamation. And so I need you to imagine the king, the one who's usually all regal and royal, sitting in ashes, dressed in sackcloth. And he says, "By the decree of the king and his nobles, no human being or animal, no herd or flock shall taste anything. They shall not feed, nor shall they drink water. Human beings and animals shall be covered with sackcloth, and they shall cry and cry mightily to God." Are your imaginations going well here? Are you imagining getting your pets dressed up in sackcloth? I know, there's probably some of you out there who dress your pets up in all kinds of stuff and post pictures on Facebook, but we're not just talking cute little puppies that you can carry in your purse. We're talking about cows and sheep and chickens and whatever else, all dressed up in sackcloth and not eating or drinking anything. I can tell you that my dog, Jesse, would not tolerate this one bit. She might cry mightily to God about it, I'm not sure. She barks a lot, I don't know what she's saying. And the king continues, "All that turn from their evil ways and from the violence that is in their hands, all shall turn away." Who knows? God may relent and change God's mind. God may turn from the fierce anger so that we do not perish. And then we jump back to the text that we heard. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God had second thoughts about the calamity that God had said would be done to them. And God did not do it. And this is where Jonah, the son of faithfulness, becomes a really petulant child. The story concludes. This was very displeasing to Jonah. And he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "Oh Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That's why I fled to Tarshish in the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and ready to relent from punishing. And now, oh Lord, please take my life from me, for it's better for me to die than to live." It's a very, very bad day. And he stomped his foot. Okay, I made that part up, but he could have. Jonah used those words that we so often sing during Lent about how God is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and makes them an accusation against God. Jonah says, "God, you're not supposed to be that way. You are supposed to hate who I hate and condemn who I would have you condemn." Have you ever felt like Jonah? And if so, which of his behaviors feel familiar to you? I won't ask you to raise your hands. How about when Jonah knows what God wants him to do, but he doesn't want to do it? Have you ever felt that way? When he runs away from God in the naive hope that God, I don't know, maybe won't notice, as if that could happen. Have you ever felt like Jonah when he's in the deepest trouble, as in deep belly of a big fish trouble? And so he's suddenly all pious and faithful, praying that God will save him? Have you ever been like that? Or when he grudgingly gets up off the beach and goes and reluctantly and just barely does what God told him to do, have you ever felt like that? Or, and this is probably the most jarring, have you ever felt like Jonah when he accuses God of being gracious and merciful and so on? There is no thankfulness in this part of the story about Jonah. Jonah, realizing that God is merciful is not good news. Jonah doesn't want God to be. Think about what's going on in our world today. And whether you're Republican or Democrat, and whether you support Israel or the Palestinians, or whether you think that Russia has a claim on Ukraine, or Ukraine has a right to itself, or add on all the countries, add on all the wars. Have you ever wanted God to do damage to those on the other side, however you define it? Sadly, I know that I have done, or at least felt like, all of those things that Jonah has done and feels like at one time or another. And here's where the importance of the story of Jonah lies. Not in a judgment of Jonah as good or bad, or whether he deserves the name dove or son of faithfulness, and not even in judgment of you or of me and how alike or unlike Jonah we are. See, we could focus on how bad Jonah is or on how bad you or I are, and I can tell us all to do better, and some days we will and some days we won't, but that's not the point of the story. The point of the story is to assure us that God meets humans wherever we are, in whatever circumstances we find ourselves. Are we like Jonah, knowing what God wants of us but not wanting to do it? Running away in the naive hope that God maybe won't notice? God doesn't abandon us even when we run away. God doesn't even let us abandon God, and rather sticks with us even in the midst of our unfaithfulness. Are we like the sailors? Putting our hope in something other than God, putting our trust in something else, and then only as a last resort, mind you, desperately praying to God, capital G, to save us, just in case God is better than the false idols that we have been worshiping. In those moments, God does not abandon us or stalk off saying, "Now you want me to listen to you?" God is faithful. Are you like Jonah when he realizes he is in deep trouble and there's absolutely nothing he can do to fix things, even in the deep, big belly of a big fish trouble? Even then, God hears our prayers. And answering our prayers may mean we're vomited up onto the beach, but God is faithful and doesn't abandon us. Are we like Jonah when he grudgingly gets up off the beach and goes and reluctantly preaches to the Ninevites? Even then, God uses his half-hearted words, his half-hearted effort to save the people of Nineveh and their sackcloth-clothed animals. God is faithful. And finally, are we like Jonah when he accuses God of being generous to those who we don't think deserve it, accusing God of being slow to anger or abounding in steadfast love and ready to relent from punishing? Or put another way, are we like Jonah in rejecting those we want to reject and wanting God to reject them too? Are we like Jonah, angry when he realizes that God is merciful and that we aren't? That God is merciful even when we don't want God to be? Here's where God's grace is like a double-edged sword. If God can love me, even knowing everything about me, and if God can love me enough to forgive me, then God can love you and everybody else that much too. And even harder yet, God invites us to love them too. Think about that John 3:16 verse that people like to throw around. For God loved the world, the cosmos. No conditions, no partitioning those who deserve and those who don't deserve, but for God so loved the world that God became human in Jesus in order to save everyone without exception. I wish everyone who read John 3:16 would keep going and read verse 17. For God did not send the Son into the world in order to condemn the world, but so that the world might be saved through him, through Jesus. Just like God loved and saved the Ninevites, just like God loved and saved Jonah, and just like God loves and saves you and me. That's the point of the Jonah story. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
rejoice with those who have committed themselves to Christ and celebrate the faith of our baptism. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we celebrate Christ embodied in human form, we pray for God's blessing on the church, the world, and all of creation. God, our rock and deliverance, do not let your church be shaken. We trust you never abandon your promises to the most vulnerable among us. Give your church wisdom and empathy in its varied ministries. God of grace, receive our prayer. God, our hope and refuge, you place the fish in the sea. Guide our care of the oceans and all creatures that live in them. Hold us accountable for actions that endanger water sources and the people who depend on them. Protect all from the extreme cold. Bless those who work to keep us safe during this time. God of grace, receive our prayer. God, who proclaims judgment and offers mercy, be a model to the leaders of our nation and the world. As they lead, may they follow in your way of justice and truth. God of grace, receive our prayer. God, who cares for the suffering, care for the survivors of assault and sexual abuse, and sustain all who minister to them. Keep safe any who live under threat of violence, those living in poverty, and any among us who are ill or in pain. God of grace, receive our prayer. God, who calls and sends disciples, encourage this congregation. Guide our call committee as they work towards finding a pastor. We pray for our interim pastor. Fill her with wisdom and strength as she prepares to lead our congregation. God of grace, receive our prayer. God, who holds the saints in your arms, we trust you welcome them into your care, especially John Bowden. Comfort those who grieve, even as we place our hope in your salvation. God of grace, receive our prayer. Knowing the Holy Spirit intercedes for us, we offer these prayers and the silent prayers of our hearts in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
We share Christ's peace with one another.
catch the sweet though far off hymn that hails a new creation. No storm can shake my inmost calm while to that rock I'm clinging, since Christ is Lord of. Makes fresh my heart, a fountain ever springing. All things are mine since I am his. How can I keep from singing? No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to
please rise. Let us pray. Let the vineyards be fruitful, Lord, and fill to the brim our cup of blessing. Gather a harvest from the seeds that were sown, that we may be fed with the bread of life. Gather the hopes and dreams of all. Unite them with the prayers we offer. Gather the hopes and give us a foretaste of the feast to come. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord. Sharing our life, he lived among us to reveal your glory and love, that our darkness should give way to his own brilliant light. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. As Christ teaches us, we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. All things are now prepared. Come and taste and see.
Oh,
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. God, for whom we wait, in this meal you gave us a foretaste of the feast to come, a feast that day when the hungry will be fed with good things. Send us forth to make known your deeds and to proclaim the greatness of your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Called your servants
to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Now go forth and grow in God.
Care in Christ.
Serve in the Spirit.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.